Luis Requena, who, as you know, is from Madrid, and we saw him speak on cutaneous paraproteins in the morning. So he's going to deliver the BSD guest lecture after we give away the prize, which is cutaneous disorders mimicking CD30 positive lymphoma histopathology. Just give us a minute here.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. So as you know, every time that we see a typical lymphocyte positive for CD30, we usually think in lymphomatoid papulosis, if the patient has multiple lesions, or an aplastic large cell lymphoma, it is solitary, a tumoral lesion. But during the last year, I have been collecting cases that we saw atypical lymphocytes, and when we stained for CD30, many of them were positive and were completely benign and inflammatory process. So I think it's important to know that there are cases that they are completely reactive, benign lesions, and they can express CD30 in the lymphocytes. So this is the list of the cases that I have seen. Probably you have experience with other process, but in my experience, the most frequent are infectious disease, mostly viral or parasitic infections. In parapox virus, in ORF and Milker nodule has been described in several case reports. So this is probably the first description. They describe three cases of Milker nodular lesions with abundant number of CD30 in the inflammatory infiltrate. In my experience, this is more frequent in ORF. You know, there's different, both of them are parapox virus infection. One is related with cow and the other with sheep. And then usually the lesions are on the fingers. This is the typical clinical presentation. And this is the histology. You see necrosis epidermis with some specific features that I will show you in a minute, and a full thickness involvement of the dermis, and the inflammatory infiltrate most of the time is very dense, very intense, and is extending to the subcutaneous tissue. The typical features are the presence of these keratotic cells. These are the inclusion bodies secondary to parapox virus infection. You can see in both, in ORF and in Milker nodules, but this is quite typical of this parapox virus infection. This is another case, always involving in areas of acral skin. In this case was ulcerated, but you see the epidermis belongs to acral skin. Histopathologic features suspicious of ORF or Milker are the presence of ballooning. You see this kind of spongiosis surrounded by ballooning keratinocytes. But when you pay attention to the infiltrate in the dermis, you see many pleomorphic, atypical, hyperchromatic lymphocytes in the infiltrate. That you stain for CD30, most of them are positive. So this is very frequent in lesions of ORF. So they are CD30 activated large lymphocytes, are a common finding in viral infections, particularly in ORF and Milker. Usually, these CD30 lymphocytes are not run in clusters, but this is a good clue to rule out lymphomatoid papulosis or anaplastic large cell lymphoma. And usually, another additional histopathologic findings are present in the biopsy, and then you can make the specific diagnosis. But I think it's crucial clinical pathologic correlation. The same is true in molluscum contagiosum. We described the first case of this atypical lymphocytes in a patient, HIV patient with molluscum contagiosum. Here you see a infundibular cyst with the typical molluscum bodies, and the inflammatory infiltrate around the bodies was composed by hyperchromatic, pleomorphic, very atypical lymphocytes. This is the patient with HIV with a widespread and very large lesion of molluscum contagiosum. And inside of the biopsy, again, you see a cystic lesion with a characteristic in molluscum body, but the inflammatory infiltrate around these viral particles is very pleomorphic, very atypical, and if you stain for 30-30, it's not so rare to see positivity. So molluscum contagiosum can be also a pseudolymphoma. Clinical lesions are typical of molluscum contagiosum. Has been described in both, in HMB positive and negative. In my experience, this kind of atypical cells are more frequent in patients with HMB infection. And the atypical lymphocytes, in most of the cases, are surrounding infundibular cysts. But if you see the characteristic molluscum bodies, I think the diagnosis is very easy. The same is true for herpes infection. This has been described in herpes simplex or in varicella zoster. This is the original description of two cases of cutaneous biopsy of herpes with a typical lymphocyte. I have seen in both in varicella or in herpes zoster, my varicella zoster virus. And today we know that the histology is different. Sometimes when you have a biopsy previous to immunohistochemistry or previous to PCR, you can suspect that if the lesion is produced by herpes simplex type 1 or 2 or because varicella zoster, because the epithelium, the involvement of the epithelium is different. Usually, herpes virus 1 or 2 involves the epidermis, in contrast with varicella zoster, that the characteristic cytopathic features of herpes infections involve the hair follicle and the sebaceous gland. Noring was demonstrated that these are typical of varicella zoster, so the epidermis is normal. You don't see any cytopathic feature of herpes, but when you go to the hair follicle of the sebaceous gland, you see the typical features with the marginal periphery of the chromatin, the so-called ground glass appearance of the nuclei, multinucleated giant cells, and necrotic keratinocytes in the sebaceous glands. So this is quite characteristic of varicella zoster involving the hair follicles, but if you go to the epidermis, there is nothing. The epidermis is normal, so this is more typical of varicella zoster than in herpes simplex type 01. So today we know that the herpes virus remain in the lymph node, and when you have the recurrent episodes, herpes simplex is going to the epidermis and varicella zoster is going to the hair follicles. This is one of the cases involving the scalp. This is the so-called pseudolymphomatous herpes. It's very difficult to suspect herpes because if you look for cytopathic features of herpes, multinucleated giant cells, ground glass appearance of the nuclei, there is nothing of that in the epidermis. But if you pay attention to the hair follicles and the sebaceous glands, this is very characteristic. You see the necrosis of the infundibulum and the sebaceous gland with this kind of dyskeratotic cells. This is highly suggestive of varicella zoster. Then you can confirm by PCR, and if the lesion is recent, sometimes it's also positive by immunohistochemical. In these cases, it's not so rare to see a typical lymphocyte. So Lorenzo Cerroni called this the pseudolymphomatous herpes infection. If you pay attention to the infiltrate around these necrotic hair follicles and sebaceous gland, you see again pleomorphic, hyperchromatic, and very large cells. And when you stain for CD30, most of them are positive. So this is the so-called pseudolymphomatous herpes infection. It has been described in both, in herpes simplex 1 and 2, and in varicella zoster. From clinical point of view, this is also difficult to diagnose because you don't see blisters, you don't see vesicles, you see hyperkeratotic lesions. Most of the time, the clinical diagnosis is viral wart or any other epidermal proliferation, and this is more frequent in patients with immunosuppression. Mostly, I have seen patients with HMV infection, then you see these keratotic lesions. From histopathology point of view, if you suspect the diagnosis, it's easy. So you have to go to the hair follicles and sebaceous gland in herpes zoster. It's more difficult if it's herpes simplex, because in this long-standing lesion, usually all cytopathic features already disappear. And you can confirm the diagnosis by immunohistochemistry. Must be a recent lesion, less than 4 weeks. After that, usually immunohistochemistry is negative, and it's more sensitive to the PCR to confirm the presence of DNA of herpes there. There are several cases of drug eruption. Drug eruptions can produce any kind of histopathology pattern, but usually with anti-epileptic drugs, with the original description was with carbamazepine, this author described a patient with a eruption, and in histology, there was many atypical lymphocytes with a T immunophenotype and with positivity for CD30. All markers for B markers were negative, and the molecular studies for gene rearrangement were negative. I have seen also cases with difenyl-edantoin. This is an epileptic patient. The woman was taking difenyl-edantoin for 2 or 3 months, and she developed this rash, widespread, symmetrical, typical of a drug eruption. And this is the histology. This has been well described. The lesions, from histopathology point of view, mimic mycosis fungoides because the inflammatory infiltrate was a little bit band-like involving the superficial dermis, and there was epidermotropic involvement with lymphocytes going into the epidermis. And when you look at higher magnification, these are completely atypical lymphocytes, pleomorphic, hyperchromatic with convoluted morphology, so mimicking mycosis fungoides. In this particular case, also, many of these large cells of atypical lymphocyte, they express CD30. We have a recent case. This woman has under treatment with nivolumab, you know, it's a new treatment for metastatic melanoma, and after 3 weeks of treatment, she developed this rash also, typical of drug eruption, widespread, symmetrical, and this is the pamba, you see a very dense band-like infiltrate involving the upper half of the dermis, and when you go to higher magnification, there were many atypical large and pleomorphic cells in the infiltrate. Again, the stain for CD30 demonstrate that these large cells were positive. So this is a drug eruption mimicking mycosis fungoides or anaplastic large cell lymphoma that is completely benign. When you stop the drug, the lesions go away. So lymphomatoid drug eruption is a very well-described entity. Most of them, and from clinical point of view, you suspect that this is a drug eruption because it's a generalized erythematous rash. Has been described mostly with anticonvulsive, anti-epileptic drugs, but you review the list in the headline, there are any kind of drug, antihistaminic and antibiotics, so it's not specific for any drug. And the same drug in some patients induce a pseudo T-cell pseudo lymphoma, and another is a B-cell pseudo lymphoma. It's difficult, so you need a clinical pathologic correlation, because when you see these atypical lymphocytes pressing positivity for CD30, you think that maybe this is a lymphomatoid papulosis or a lymphoma. In all these cases, molecular studies are polyclonal, so maybe it's helpful. In scabies, especially in nodular scabies, it's not so rare to see atypical lymphocytes, and many of them were positive for CD30. This is the original description by Fernando Gallardo in Barcelona. They describe a small series. And when I read the paper and I review my cases of nodular scabies, this is not so rare to see atypical lymphocytes, and if you stain for CD30, there are several large cells. So these are the typical clinical lesions of nodular scabies, more common in the genital area. If you take a biopsy and you don't have clinical information, you think that maybe this is a lymphoma or a pseudo lymphoma, because there is dense infiltrate of lymphocytes with many atypical cells. Probably a good clue is the presence of many eosinophils, but if you stain for CD30, most of the large cells are positive, and then you can make a mistake if you don't have clinical information. This is another patient with nodular scabies with the typical genital or perigenital involvement, and again, the biopsy, there was many atypical lymphocytes. So in this case, the inflammatory infiltrate was mostly band-like, with no epidermotropic involvement. There are some spongiosis in the epidermis, but when you go to higher magnification, there are many atypical lymphocytes in the infiltrate. Again, the presence of the eosinophils is a good clue, but remember, eosinophils are not so rare in lymphomatoid papulosis or in mycosis fungoides, so you need clinical pathologic correlation. In these cases, in nodular scabies, you don't see the mite, you don't see the Sarcoptes scabiei, but sometimes, even before the nodular scabies period, you can see patients with widespread scabies, and you can suspect the presence of Sarcoptes scabiei because you see the tunnel beneath the epidermis, or within the epidermis, you see the hole that the mite of Sarcoptes scabiei was crossing, and again, you see in the dermis there are many atypical lymphocytes with a lot of eosinophils, and the immune staining in this case, most of the cells were T lymphocytes, and there were, especially the large cells, were positive for CD30. So the immunophenotype is very similar to lymphomatoid papulosis, and even more because the proliferation index with Ki-67 was very high. So usually in nodular scabies, you don't see the mite, you don't see the Sarcoptes scabiei, but even in scabies, before the period of nodular scabies, this is another section of the same case. We cut serial sections and we identify the mite of Sarcoptes. So in scabies you see that, but in nodular scabies you don't see, usually you don't see the mite. So this is frequent in my experience, both in biopsy for the scabies and in nodular scabies. Not more frequent in nodular scabies. You see this chronic variant with this very dense, infiltrate of atypical lymphocytes, and some of them express CD30, and usually in other scabies, sarcopter scabies is not there already. This is not just in scabies, has been described also in other parasitic lesions, especially in leishmaniasis, and also in bacterial or in spirochete infection like in syphilis. I have seen also cases of leishmaniasis. This is a woman from Morocco, from the north of Africa, with these linear lesions without any sporotrichosis or some sporotrichoid infection, and the histology was quite characteristic for leishmaniasis. You see very dense nodular infiltrate involving the full thickness of the dermis with two components, lymphocytes at the periphery with some plasma cells and more histiocytic infiltrate in the center. At higher magnification, the lymphocytes were really atypical and pleomorphic. Here you see at higher magnification, many of the histiocytes, they have a lot of Leishmania bodies inside of the cytoplasm, and in US stain for CD30, many of the lymphocytes were positive. The same is true for syphilis, especially in patients with immunosuppression. This is an HMV-positive patient with secondary syphilis. Usually in this patient, the lesions are more necrotic, more nodular. We saw in lymphomatoid papulosis in this case, because we didn't know that the patient had syphilis. The inflammatory, the infiltrate, so the lesion is ulcerated and covered by a crust. And you see a very wave-shaped, dense infiltrate involving the upper half of the dermis with a lot of pleomorphic and atypical lymphoid cells. Probably here the clue is the presence of plasma cells. So you see plasma cells with this very dense lymphocytic infiltrate, you have to think in the so-called malignant syphilis. This kind of syphilis is mostly seen in patients with HMV infection. If you stain for a CD30, this infiltrate, again, there are a small cluster or scattered large cells positive for CD30. Here the diagnosis today is easy. I remember in the past we need serology, but now we got a super antibody. It's not completely specific, but the antibody against treponema pallidum, even in these late stage lesions of secondary syphilis, in the middle of this dense nodular infiltrate, you can identify the presence of the spirochetes. So treponema pallidum is there, and then the diagnosis is syphilis. So we must include the simulator of lymphomatoid papulosis or anaplastic cell lymphoma, leishmaniasis, and syphilis. Usually, there are clues. You see the leishmania bodies in the cytoplasm of the histiocytes, and again, we have a very good antibody to stain leishmanias. Or we see the treponema pallidum with the immunohistochemistry, then the correct diagnosis is easy. Eosinophilic ulcer of the tongue. In my experience, this is also frequent. Sometimes we see an ulcerated lesion present for long time, and the clinical diagnosis is squamous cell carcinoma, but we take a biopsy, and we see the typical eosinophilic infiltrate. This is one of the cases, not on the tongue, it's in the oral mucus, and the most frequent location is on the tongue. And this is the punch biopsy, you see hyperplastic epidermis, and a dense inflammatory infiltrate with a lot of atypical lymphocytes, but the presence of many, many eosinophils is a good clue for the diagnosis. You see atypical lymphocytes, and when you stain for CD30, many of these lymphocytes are positive. So this is also another mimicker of lymphoma or lymphomatoid papulosis. It's rare to have oral involvement in this kind of lymphoproliferative disorder, but I have seen cases of lymphomatoid papulosis involving the oral mucus, so it's not so difficult. This is very curious. In the last year, we have seen several cases of patients that they have atypical lymphocytes within the lumina of the vessel of the dermis. And this is a completely benign process. So every time that we see atypical lymphocytes in the lumina of the vessels of the dermis within an intravascular lymphoma, most of the cases is a very aggressive lymphoma, B immunophenotype, more rare is T lymphoma. But there are cases completely benign, reacted, inflammatory condition, and this has been described secondary to many etiologies, drug, traumatism, and has been also well described in the blood vessels or other lesions, in hemangioma, in pyogenic granuloma, if you pay attention to intravascular involvement, you see very atypical lymphocytes. In all these cases, if you are stained by immunohistochemistry for the vessels, they are lymphatic vessels. So this is an intralymphatic atypical proliferation of CD30 T lymphocytes. This is one of the cases that I have seen. You see dilated lymphatics, and in some of them, the lumina is filled by these very atypical and very pleomorphic lymphocytes. When you do the immunophenotype, they express T cell markers, proliferation is very high, and many of them express CD30. And if you stain for podoplanin or for PROS1 or LIG1, all immunohistochemical markers for lymphatic endothelial cells, you demonstrate that most of these atypical lymphocytes are in the lumina or lymphatic. So it's an intra-lymphatic proliferation of atypical T lymphocytes. You review the literature, this has been described, Lorenzo Cerrone described, in the lymphatic vessels of a pyogenic granuloma in a hemangioma, and Dr. Rodriguez Peralta in Madrid also described two cases in granulation tissue. In pyogenic granuloma lesion is not so rare, to see this very atypical intralymphatic proliferation of CD30, so you had to rule out intralymphatic intravascular lymphoma. This is completely benign. It's a histopathology finding, and all these patients, when you have the follow-up, they are completely healthy. This is the second case of Dr. Rodriguez Peralto. Again, the same features, very atypical pleomorphic hyperchromatic lymphocytes within the lumina of lymphatics, and they express CD30. So there is a recent paper of Lorenzo Cerroni, reviewed the literature, and he described an additional case in a patient with hidradenitis suppurativa. So you can see in many inflammatory conditions now this kind of proliferation. And the last case, no inflammatory, it's tumoral, but Dr. Eloy Rodriguez in Asturias in Spain, he described positivity for CD30 and the inflammatory infiltrate of cutaneous lymphadenoma or and trichoblastoma. The other name for this lesion is adamantinoid trichoblastoma. Today, most of the experts think that this is an inflamed trichoblastoma. It's very curious when you stain for CD30. I have down in 10 cases of my file of here you see the typical features of the adamantinoid trichoblastoma or cutaneous lymphadenoma. You see the epithelial aggregates scattered by a lot of lymphocytes with a lot of pleomorphic cells, some edema, and sometimes you have the mucin, and you see the typical stroma of trichoblastoma, very dense cellular with a lot of fibroblasts, when they reproduce the follicular papilla around these epithelial aggregates. When you stain for 30, not just the infiltrate, I don't know why, but I think also the epithelium of trichoblastoma is not so rare expressing 30, and this is a completely benign neoplasm with follicular differentiation. So this is the summary of the cases that I have seen. If you review the literature, probably there are more. So you can see CD30 infiltrate in herpes infection. So the clue are the presence of necrotic keratinocytes in the epidermis or in the hair follicle or sebaceous gland when the infection is secondary to varicella zoster. Very frequent in parapox virus, both in ORF and microlodons. The clue for the right diagnosis is the presence of the ballooning and necrosis of the upper layers of the epidermis. Molluscum contagiosum is not so rare, especially in HIV patients. You see atypical lymphocytes, and you stain for CD30, it's possible to see very atypical lymphocytes, but the clue is very easy when you see the molluscum bodies. Secondary to insect bite of the scabies, not so rare in chronic lesion, especially in nodular scabies. You can see very atypical lymphocytes, and in these cases, you need clinical pathologic correlation because it's difficult to, in nodular scabies, usually you don't identify Charcoptes scabiei. Many drugs. Originally, it was described as antiepileptic drugs, but today there are antihistaminic, antibiotics, antihypertensive. So, in the new treatments for melanoma, there are also cases. So, drug erosions can mimic anaplastic large cell lymphoma, lymphomatoid papulosis, mycosis fungoides, you need clinical pathologic correlation. In leishmaniasis and in syphilis, in both, it's very frequent to see atypical lymphocytes as you stain for CD30. Many of the large cells and the atypical lymphocytes are positive. Here, The diagnosis usually is easy because in Leishmaniasis you see the Leishmania bodies, and if you suspect syphilis, you can stain the treponema. Even in this late state of secondary syphilis, still you can identify the spirochete there. Very typical in eosinophilic ulcer of the tongue, there are a lot of atypical lymphocytes positive for CD30. Atypical intravascular, more correct, atypical intralymphatic lymphocytes can be seen in many inflammatory conditions, trauma in the vessels of hemangioma and granulation tissue, so it's not so rare to see that. And if you stain for CD30 adamantinoid trichoblastoma, not just the inflammatory infiltrate, not just the lymphocyte, also the epithelium express this marker. So this is my conclusion. It's not so rare to see CD30 activate the lymphocytes. Most of the time they are T lymphocytes, but in some rare cases also B lymphocytes can express CD30. In many inflammatory conditions, so the typical immunohistochemical pattern with a staining the Golgi paranuclear positivity. So in my opinion, CD30 staining must be evaluated in the context on other clinical and histopathologic features, because the positivity for this marker alone doesn't provide any diagnostic information. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Luis. Any questions for Dr. Requena? Yes, Reno?
Thank you very much, Lewis, and it just shows you that there are probably more CD30 positive skin infiltrates than probably CD30 positive lymphomas that we see, and you make the point very well that clinicopathological correlation is so important. I would even take that even further. I think as practicing dermatopathologists, I think we need as much information when the biopsy is submitted, and I would probably, I don't know if in your practice, we have to beg for the photo to see what the thing looks like. The other thing is, I'm so pleased that you're still using the term pseudolymphoma, which I still use. I'm told it's outdated. I'm not sure it is. I think in this context it's perfect. And lastly, I think before making a rushed diagnosis, I mean, we had a case recently of scabies that was a CD30 positive, is to wait and see and at least provide, I like to say, three consecutive skin biopsies before you make a lifetime commitment of lymphoma.
Yes. Thank you very much. So I completely agree. I'm lucky because I am a dermatologist and I see the patient, but I have the same problem in my hospital with the pathology. So I spend more time in pathology department because I like dermatopathology, but it's the same. So for every time that you see pseudolymphoma to the lymphomaniacs in my hospital, they don't accept the diagnosis. Okay, I say, okay, tell me another one. Sometimes you can make a specific diagnosis if you see nodular scabies or a drug eruption, but if you study with all immunohistochemical molecular and you are sure that this is not lymphoma, but sometimes pseudolymphoma is the only diagnosis that you can do. But I agree, the pathologists don't like the diagnosis of pseudolymphoma, but sometimes it's the only thing that we can say.
Thank you. Any other questions? So thank you once again for that excellent presentation.